I extend a heartfelt welcome to all of you as we gather here for the sixth edition of BizNight via webinar session. Yes, we are all going webinar these days. So this is not an exception in this virtual world. So introducing myself, I am Bismay Kumar Purohit, Senior Business Process Consultant for ThoughtWorks, and I will be your host for the rest of the evening. Now, before we start off, there are a few housekeeping rules I would like to extend to all the audience here. The number one is we request every one of you to mute all your handheld devices, your cell phones, any multitaskings. This is just to ensure we have your undivided attention. It's always good to have. Second point, please put yourself on mute if you're not speaking. And while the session is underway, this will ensure we have clear audio and there are no hindrances going forward. The third point is for a better experience, I encourage every one of you to kind of put the Zoom in speaker view. In that way, you can feel like you're having one-on-one. Now, to start off with, I would like to tell you a brief about BizNight. In the past edition, BizNight have always provided a platform to bring together business analysts, project managers, product managers, aka product enthusiasts, to explore new ideas and techniques about products, ideas in this ever-changing era. And tonight, we too shall collaborate to find out the answers to some of the few enticing and exciting questions that are available in the market. Now, let me ask you a question. So in this era of product, what do we need? Whom do we need to get the product going? We need product managers. So the product manager's responsibility, I won't say responsibility, it's on their shoulders to ensure that the ideas turn into reality and the products soar high. But how do they do that? What is the driving force behind it? You know, what's the secret? What's the secret ingredient? I'm pretty sure you all have seen Kung Fu Panda movie, right? So what's the secret ingredient that they add in their dish that makes them go gaga, right? So to explore such questions, we have the topic for the evening, which you can see right on my screen, is that placing the winning bet in products. Now, when I say that, I can virtually see that a lot of enthusiasm and excitement build around. I can see that, relax. So, don't you feel that we should know the recipe, how it is done, what is being added, and all that? So to give a taste of the entire cooking, we have with us a master chef. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you all to Mr. Jasjeet Singh. Mr. Singh leads the product for developer experience and platform monetization for OLX market across the globes. Before that, he served as the director of product for MobiQuick and Wink Music. I'm pretty sure you all have used the Wink Music app, right? And before that, he did build the mobile platform for Nimbus. Not to forget, he led the development for BlackBerry's advertising services back in those days. Yeah, remember when BlackBerry was a rage? Yeah, Jasjeet was there. Jasjeet graduated from Georgia Tech in human computer interactions and has been a vocal advocate of user-centric designs and responsible for product development and building and creating impact all over the scale. So with that, I hand over the webinar to the master chef. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hand together for Jasjeet Singh. Jasjeet?
Yeah.
Let me get over to you.
Sure. First of all, thanks a lot for the kind words. I think I really appreciate ThoughtWorks inviting me over and having this session on cookery. Well, that's what it seems like, right? But I think it's a mix of not only cookery, but also a gamble, right? We all play gambles, but how do you make more sense out of it is something that I will be talking about today. So Bismay, if you could start the next slide. Cool. The first one. Yes, just here. So this is where we start our exploration, and in this I would want to want your participation as well, because everyone whom I ask this question, right, why do we need a product manager? We come up with our own definition, we come up with our own understanding, expectation, and that is where the real problem lies, right? So a quick 1 minute thing, so what do you think, why do we need product managers?
So that we don't deviate from our objective. So that we don't deviate from our set objective.
Okay. So so there are certain objectives that you need to meet, and you need a police to kind of manage the expectations so that we don't move here and there, right? So, okay. Anything else?
So we typically have a delivery and the customers. And then the product manager has to manage both the delivery part and focus on the customers and focus on the essentials which are needed so that they have a clear set of objectives how the product roadmap should be.
Okay, so basically figure out what is the essential part that needs to be done so that the customer expectations are met. Anything else?
So what I've heard is product manager is a mini CEO for that product. Right. So I think just like a company needs a CEO to run the company for a product, right? All those functions, I think, apply. Maybe few functions don't, but you know, from ideation to growing the product, marketing strategy, you know, facing it out, the entire life cycle of the product need to be managed, and various functions are there. So I think just like a company needs a CEO, now product needs a product manager to manage and coordinate all the various aspects.
So we've got someone who course corrects, someone who's polices, someone who manages the expectations between the client and the what has to be delivered, a mini CEO, anything else?
Might be someone who converts your dreams into reality.
Dreams into reality. I really love that. Okay. Anything else?
So product manager, a guy who deliver and design customer-centric products within the company's capacity by using all the resources.
Okay. So basically he is a resource planner and makes sure that whatever gets delivered is within whatever the company budgets are, and basically he's managing the whole show over there. Okay. Anything else? Cool. So now what we have seen, right? Even in this small group, we see different aspects of product management. It is almost very similar to the elephant in the room when we are trying to kind of figure out what is that definition of a product manager. So if you really ask me, right, what is a product manager and why do we need a product manager? I think I have been asking this question for my, like, when I entered product management to the time right now. And one thing that has really stuck to me is that if you had infinite resources, right, and infinite problems are always infinite. So infinite problems and infinite resources, you actually don't need a product manager. You build 100 things, out of which 10 work, 90 don't work, but the 10 are working, which is fine. So you have something out there, which is working really well, right? So you actually don't need a product manager. But why do we need a product manager? Because the problems are, of course, infinite. But the resources that we have who can work on those problems are very limited, right? And that is a typical, like, even in your cases, right, you would have seen that where do we need products? We typically need where there is a mismatch of demand and supply, right? And product manager itself is a function that basically manages this demand and supply. And how do we do that? We look at, like, what are the problems that we should be picking up? And how do we prioritize the right problem so that at the end, the impact is more, right? So in order to do that, you are managing client expectations, you are managing the whole show that we don't deviate, don't pick up problems that don't matter. We seem to think that we are the mini CEOs, but if you ask a product manager, are you a mini CEO? He'll probably say no, but anyways, so let's go with that, right? So all that is an outcome of the whole function that basically, if you have infinite problems and you need to solve certain problems to bring impact, you need a product manager to orchestrate this, prioritize this, and make sure that whatever it's delivered is something that brings impact. And what is this impact? In terms of learning, understanding the user, understanding the experience, understanding the whole product journey, and then taking it to the market. Cool. Bismay, the next thing. So that's why I asked Bismay that, like, until or unless I say next, don't press the next button, because this is what I had in my mind, that if I had infinite resources and infinite problems to solve, I actually don't need product managers, right? So everything gets built, gets done, and we go from there. Any questions, any thoughts on this? Because this is where the whole crux of expectations of a product manager, and hence the whole function, and hence the whole process of working, comes down to.
Yeah, I don't know whether it's the right time for question, but so the project manager, right? I mean, like somehow I feel like, you know, similar definitions might get applied also, not maybe the exact, but about managing resources. In my understanding, it's more than, you know, the resource management, right? How do we differentiate, like, you know, product manager and project manager if the definition is this, right?
See, of course. So when you have a project manager, he is trying to manage the timelines basis whatever that is known, trying to uncover the unknowns so that people can resolve all those differences and deliver. So this is a delivery focus. Project management is a delivery focus function. In this case, we are actually looking at problems. So what are the problems that need to be picked up, which are very important for the deliver, for whatever you're working to bring impact. So that is where the slight but very important difference between a product manager and a project manager. But yeah, let's move forward, and then let's bring this back into the discussion as we move forward.
Just one more question.
Let's go further. Sure.
What's the difference between product manager and a product owner?
So I think the definition depends from company to company, organization to organization, culture to culture. In some places, a product owner is a part of the Scrum or the Agile process, who basically is working with the engineering manager, or is the engineering manager as well, who is working on the end-to-end delivery and time, and basically managing the whole expectation thing. And sometimes it is used interchangeably with the product manager. So it depends from the from the organization to organization, and the kind of organization you are, right? In some organizations which are very business focused, some are very design focused, some are very technology focused. So in each of these organizations, the roles will basically fluctuate between the different things, and it may vary from context to context.
Thank you.
But yeah, cool. Let's move forward. So what I did, I think we can go through the next one, the next ingredients in it. So what I did was I looked at what are the various things that make a great product, right? So I looked at various examples in the industry, and what is it that really makes a difference, right? So Bismay, the next one. In this, what I figured is, it starts from the customer. So we talked about customer-centric way of working, right? So that means that you not only know the customer, the target audience that you have, but you also try and figure out the context in which that target audience or the customer is using our product, right? So understanding the whole relationship of why we are doing what we are doing, and then understanding where in his life is that product solving a problem. While we are looking at the customer and the overall his environment in which he is living, we also try to understand what are the current pain points. So that becomes a very important ingredient in then looking at what are the problems, and hence framing or reframing the problems. So I usually give an example at this phase that once upon a time, what happened was it is early 1800s where they installed a escalator or a lift in a building, And this is, I think, this is a story from UK or somewhere where initial experiments were done. And people would sit into that elevator and go to the fifth or the sixth floor. And a typical complaint that usually came in that building was that this lift is very slow. Of course, the technology wasn't that advanced. Things were slow. So they were like really, really pissed off that I might as well climb the stairs rather than come through the escalator. So there was a guy on the first, on the third floor. What he did was he placed a mirror, right? Again, like, before going there, like everyone said that, okay, yeah, let's bring this down. Let's rebuild this, right? The whole journey end to end again. And hopefully with this better motors, better engines, better everything. And so now the lift would go very quickly. But it is, of course, a lot of investment. Let's make that investment happen, right? And then there was some guy in the third floor. What he said was, he went there and quietly placed a mirror in the lift, right? And what happened was, all of a sudden, the people in the lift who were going in that lift, they felt that the lift was very fast because they were looking at the mirror and they didn't know before they would go, they would reach their floors. So all of a sudden, the problem of changing the whole mechanism of a lift got replaced by placing a mirror, because now they were so engrossed looking at their own photo that it didn't matter, right? So in this context, this becomes really, really important that sometimes you need to frame or reframe your problems better so that you can look at alternative spaces, so that sometimes the most obvious ones are the better solutions, or sometimes like thinking out of the box really helps in framing that in a better impactful way. Then of course, out of those problems, how do you bring the most important problem, which is a prioritization, and then how do you discover solutions with your customers, and then how do you set expectations with the stakeholders? And in this, as you go from your starting point of a journey to the end of the journey, how do you iterate and do your experiment design well so that you learn with every step that you are taking in this journey, right? And this is where all of this comes together as a product function. So this is what I feel are the some of the various ingredients that go in making sure that whatever you're doing delivers more impact. Let's go further. And the next one. So what I did was I also looked at what are the various things that the industry is doing to make sure that the product managers are basically more effective in their work. And whatever I described is as a journey of from ideation to understanding pain points to delivery. What is it that people do in the industry, right? So there is a section of product companies that use the blue ocean strategy, which basically focuses on the pain points. And then on those pain points, they look at what are the differentiating factors that separate you out from your competition, so that whatever you deliver, it has a unique value. Next is the portfolio thinking, where the emphasis is on maximizing returns, right? So what is it that you would do that returns? So I think what we've also figured is the product strategy is also dependent on the kind of business or kind of products that you are building, the nature of how you function. Some of them are transaction in nature. Some of them are mostly delight in nature. So it depends from which function you are performing. Basis that, what kind of a strategy that you can use to basically do the same thing that I described in the previous slide. Let's go further. These days, technology companies have started adopting a lot of OKRs. So that is your objective and key results. So again, basis starting from the customer pain points, or what do you define? What is your vision? From your vision, what are your objectives? And for the objectives, what are the key results that or the matrices that you would measure so that you identify that this is my success criteria of this objective, and this is how then you go back and onto the drawing board and then understand what is it that you should be doing to cover that gap, and what are the bets that you should be placing so that you achieve your success criteria. Next. And of course, this is what Amazon also follows, that as a product manager, you would visualize your success and share a note on what the user would see when this product gets rolled out, in terms of summary, in terms of context, in terms of problem, in terms of use cases. So all that gives you a perspective of what is it that you are finally trying to achieve. Because what happens is, there are various small nuances and in which you as a product manager kind of get to stuck. And when you get stuck, you lose the bigger picture. So this actually helps you in that course correction or making sure that you are aligned to a certain direction while you are envisaging the end state. So these are some of the strategies that are there in the market that people use to basically navigate through the chaos of understanding a user, understanding his pain points, and then taking it from there, what are the right problems to solve and what are the solutions that solve that problem, and how do we kind of go out in the market. So let's go further. So this is actually this is very, very interesting. So maybe if you can go to the next one, I'll go through the various steps. So these are things that we follow at OLX, and I've been here in OLX for about 4 years now, and we've scaled a lot of products in terms of monetization, dealers, and things like that. So one thing that really helped us in our journey was we broke the problems or the whole space into what are the problem opportunity areas, right? So we have a problem opportunity backlog, we have a discovery backlog, and then we have experiments or the rollouts that need to happen. So first I'll talk about the customer pain points or the problem opportunity backlog. So the problem opportunity assessment is like, I am a really simple guy, and I refrain from all the complex frameworks that people use. This is something that I really love that in this is these are simple questions that once you start asking yourself, you yourself start doing more due diligence. So again, simple problems like what problem are we trying to solve, right? How big is this problem? How unique is this problem? What will be the impact of the problem, right? So how do you validate this? How do you understand? How do you get answers to this? You basically look at data, you look at the user research in the customer life, where that problem is, and you are try to identify or size that problem. So this is what I call as a problem opportunity backlog, where we are trying to rank order the problems that are there, that we know as of now, these are problem hypotheses. So we validate these problem hypotheses basis research, basis data, and this has a direct impact on the objectives that we have taken for the quarter. Next comes the discovery of solutions. So discovery of solutions, I think one of the things that I have learned over time is that we product managers are very passionate about what we think is right. We think that whatever we think is right, right? So that is where the whole problem comes, that we are also humans, and we also look through our lenses, and more often than not, these are constrained by our own experiences. So what I typically do in this is that call it as a discovery of solutions, wherein we try to answer this with our stakeholders. So what are the best problems to solve? So once you have identified, okay, these are the rank order of the problems. Now we look at how do we know that what are the variants of solution that solve that problem, and how do we validate this, right? How can we co-create this with our stakeholders and figure out how do we solve a particular problem, right? And this is problem opportunity was more about understanding the problem space. Discovery of solution is more about what are the variants of solutions and how do you validate that variant of solution is actually solving the problems you had identified in the last step. So in this, you would typically do usability testing. You would look at previous experiments, learn from there, and then devise prototypes or algorithms, roll them, and basically from there you go to the next step. And the next step over here is how do you make your experiment design really lean, so that how will you know that this actually works, right? So if you have $100 in your pocket, how do you want to spend that $100 so that you can have maximum impact, right? So that is where an incremental approach of learning is something that we follow, wherein from the problems to the discovery of variants to actual rolling it out basis the known and the unknown, you take a call that is, should this be an experiment or should this be a rollout? So we usually do an incremental piecemeal kind of a thing, so that we learn more and we understand more, so that we can course correct our direction as we move forward, right? And let's go further. Now, this brings me to a very interesting point in our journey. We started off with customer, we started off with a recipe. We then went into the problem opportunity, discovery, all good fundas, right? All good things that may be useful, may not be useful. But to emphasize that how important is this? This is how a typical product lifecycle looks like as of now, right? Wherein you have certain needs, you observe, you prioritize, you brainstorm, you build those hypotheses. This is where I am talking about building a problem opportunity backlog, right? And then from there, you discover, you learn more, and then you experiment, right? As you experiment, you build it, and then you have feedback, you have new ideas, and you build again and again. And just a quick question here, where do you think we spend the most amount of time? Anyone?
Maybe brainstorming.
Brainstorming, okay. Anyone else?
I guess we spend time building it while we should be spending more time in the earlier red part.
Absolutely, absolutely. So the maximum amount of investment or the time that is spent at this build it, right? And the more you build, the more difficult it becomes to course correct, right? Over in the earlier part of this cycle, everything is on the brain, everything is in documents, right? It is very easy for you to change course correct, do anything that you want. But once you've started building it, then that is your point of no return, because then you've put in a lot of investment, right? And that is where the problem opportunity assessment, discovery and everything actually brings a lot of impact that you want to build, right? So by the time you reach build it, you should have done your due diligence, so that when you reach it, you're absolutely confident of what you're building brings impact. Let's go further. I have a few points over here as well. So again, as I was talking, this is where you frame your problems, next step. And this is where you are discovering your solutions and working with the customers. Yes, next. This is where you iterate and basis your learning. And right, and this is where you start managing stakes and selling your story, right? And sometimes the selling of story happens even in the hypothesis phase, wherein you are trying to align people, and that happens throughout this journey. But the most crucial part is the build it, right? So again and again, I will emphasize on this, that the better problem assessment that you have done, the better discovery of solutions that you have done, you have a better chance to be able to deliver things that bring more impact, right? So if you are starting to create your user story and you are starting with the user stories which says that as a customer, I want this, you've actually lost the plot, right? Your user story should start with what is the problem, right? It's a problem opportunity. So because what also happens, what really helps you is your story becomes even more compelling, because now when a developer looks at it and says that, okay, wow, this is why I am doing this, because now I am doing this because this delivers, this is the problem that we are trying to solve, right? This is the discovery of variants of things that the product manager has tested. And this is where I am actually doing this. So once you start doing this over and over again, right, it really, really is fast, right? And it gives confidence to not only the product manager, but also the technology team that they are building things that actually matter, right? And they can then they can actually come back to you and say, boss, the solution that you are saying, I have a better solution than this, right? Then it is a conversation starter rather than something that is being forced on the throat of people. This becomes a more of a discussion and alignment of what is the best product that we can go out in the market. And that is also the essence of Agile, right? So that is where this all thing comes together when you have done your due diligence and now you are building things that bring impact. Cool. Let's go further. And one interesting question that I usually get asked is that this all is good, right? This app makes absolute sense. But how do I know that where I should do usability testing versus how do I know that, can I just talk to a user and decide that this is working for me or not? Should I do a paper prototype? Should I do a experiment? Should I actually roll out and see the data? What should I do? Right. So that is where this kind of, at least in my mind, helps me clear my thoughts. So next over there. So this is what we call the truth curve, right? So the y-axis is the truth of learning, how much you know, because what happens is the amount of unknowns is a huge risk, right? So the things that you know, you can control. Things that you don't know or you can't measure is something that you can't improve on, right? So that is the y-axis. The x-axis is the amount of effort, right? And sometimes what happens is the effort is low. You know that maybe just like it's a trapdoor experiment, right? I want to know how many people would want to use this new feature, right? I can just have that same CTA or a URL or a link where people would click, and I would measure that how many people are actually interested there. And in when you click on it, it would say coming soon, right? So that way, there have been instances where we have had very tough fights with stakeholders. No, I want this feature. This is something that is really path breaking for me, this and that. We would just put in a small link saying that, okay, this is where it is. People would not click, right? So then you would then want to understand why they have not clicked. Of course, that is a second process altogether, but it gives you some indications with low effort. Can you understand what is it? How much of the unknowns can you mitigate, right? So this is how you could basically increase the fidelity of your validation basis the learning that you won't want or the risk that you have. So if you have a high risk, sometimes even rollouts work very well, because they give you live data and then you can make an educated call that at this scale for this kind of a target audience, this is what works, this is what doesn't work. And hence I need to double down on certain things. So this is how this basically helps you to increase fidelity and take a call that what is it that you should be doing in this journey to make sense. Cool. Next, let's go further. So now I will, all that gyan that I have been giving up till now, I will talk about like how did we use it in the journeys that I have done thus far. And I have been very fortunate and lucky to have been part of very good product journeys, and I learned a lot in those journeys. So first the case study which I'll be talking about is Wink Music. So I think when I joined Wink, it had already launched. And at that point of time, the focus was that how do we basically grow the business or grow the number of streams per month with whatever we can do, right? So at that point of time, of course, like as a product manager, your first instinct is that, yeah, I want to solve a customer pain point wherein he is currently not able to discover content, and hence I would want to do machine learning or AI ML kind of a thing, wherein I surface the right content and all of a sudden my number of streams per user would increase, right? That is a good hypothesis, because in a content platform, content is the king. Your product is secondary, because at if you can surface the right content at the right time, you would have that user, right? And that is your typical approach. And the other part was that that we also at that point of time wanted to live the life of a user. We actually did a lot of jogging, going in public transport, looking at people, how are they using the products, how are they listening to all the things, right? Do they feel that problem of searching through the content, or is it what kind of a problem are we trying to solve, right? So for us, I think it became like all of a sudden, like over a period of like when we were trying to solve this, we figured out that this is not about solutioning, right? This is about identifying the right problem. So we then followed the pirate matrix, wherein we've kind of looked at the whole customer funnel in terms of acquisition, activation, retention, and then of course the revenue. And what we figured out is that there were small problems that were destroying the whole experience, right? It was never about content, right? Content not showing up. So fortunately in Wink, we had a team of curators who were curating the content, and which was one of the best curating teams that I have ever worked with. They were amazingly well versed with the latest things, and they would do their magic. So what we figured is that after talking to a lot of users, understanding, we figured that in the acquisition funnel, at that point of time, we had many inorganic channels through which a lot of customers were coming in and they were dropping off. So first thing that we did was we looked at what are the channels where these matrices are, where the average retention is lower than the average retention, right? And first of all, what we did was first remove those, basically because it was pulling down all the numbers that we had, and doubled down on the channels which were working very, really well for us. So in this, again, it starts from what is the problem that we are trying to solve? How do you discover that, what are the right problems to solve for? In this case, we figured out there were some channels which were not performing well. So our acquisition funnel was bad. In addition to that, we figured that in this, people were coming in, right? There was this a lot of content, and they would be confused, like, what do I do next, right? Should I press on something? Should I press on the player? Like, it was very difficult for them to understand that what should be my first action. So that is where we understood a lot about the human behavior of when you come into a music app, what is the context with which he's entering in, and can we smoothen that experience out? So we did some experiments on that. On the acquisition or the activation side, it was actually like really simple things that were killing the experience. We figured that when you were coming in, you would play a song, and at that point of time, 4G was not that great, but even then, when you play a song, the next song that would play, you had a time gap in it, right? And because of that, people were listening to a song, and then it took all a lot of time to kind of play the next song. And because of that, people were dropping off, right? And what we had done, we wanted to be best in class, and we always started with the highest bitrate. And because of that, like, it was all messing up the whole experience. So again, we course corrected that. And that is where I think the key message over here is that it's not about thinking it from a solution side, but thinking it from an experience standpoint. What are the problems that are actually a pain point in the user journey, and how can we solve for it? The other thing that we discovered in this space was that when we are talking to users, we actually saw this in our data, that people who play radio, so radio was auto playing of songs in a basic curated list, the retention was higher, right? And people who played singles, the retention was poor. So we brought out our radios more, right? We actually like used the Airtel's network to understand in tier 2, tier 3 cities that why is it that people don't use Wink as much as we wanted as compared to tier 1 cities back then. So what we figured, like, again, my hunch at that point of time was, tier 2, tier 3 cities have 2G network. They can't play. And hence, unless the network speed improves, I can't do anything about it, right? But then we figured out, like, okay, so then we took a step back and we asked the customers that, how do you listen to music these days? So what they were doing is basically they were sideloading their music, sideloading the music in their phones and listening to them over and over again. So that was a big opportunity for us to understand that user behavior and maybe include that in our product so that more often than not, they come to the product and meanwhile discover that whatever options that are available, because networks over that time also, they were reasonably well. The bit rate and the bit quality was reasonably well, even for tier 2, tier 3 cities. But because their favorite music was already curated, because they would sideload and use that, they were not even willing to discover this content. So all these insights were actually a lot of problem opportunity assessment, a lot of discovery of solutions, thinking about variants. So again, you could go into recommendation engine or you could fix these small things. So this is what we did, a lot of these things. And I think Chandrasekhar was the product CPO at that point of time for Airtel. And he asked me like, what kind of target that you want to take? So we were doing about, I think, 15 million streams per month. At that point of time, it was just the beginning time. And I said, let's target 40 million. So actually everyone in that room laughed. So I said, let's revisit it as we move forward. And we were actually able to do 35 millions per month. And since then, the retention and everything was so good that Airtel wanted to kind of market it out, and how now it is like touching the roofs. So, but the basics of a product, so it doesn't need to be a jazzy or a very sexy solution. It has to be something that solves a customer pain point. Next. So in this, I'll talk a little bit about MobiQuick. I think what happened was Paytm at that point of time had rolled out the bus booking, and there was a lot of pressure on us to kind of follow that. And what we did was, the other one was that we were actually doing really well in capturing the offline market. Offline market is like the big bazaars of the world, where you would use their wallet to transact and complete the transaction, sometimes via SMS, QR codes, all that nice stuff, which is now very common. At that point of time, these were like early initiatives that we wanted to do. So when I was looking at this, the comparison, like what would bring me a bigger impact? So I looked at like the bus booking. So how a bus booking would work is that the Paytms of the world or the MobiQuicks of the world would be aggregators. We would basically generate a lead, send it to someone the other players in this space. They would then send an SMS to the customer confirming the booking and things like that. They would manage the whole experience and close it, right? So you as a customer, you as a platform don't have much control on the whole experience. So that is where we felt that at that point in time, the impact would be far higher if we do more diversification of the methods for offline payments. And that is what we decided over here, that can we do more in understanding what are the various segments in the offline space. So one was this big domain wherein you have the big bazaar and all the other big segments of big merchants over there. The second one was the mom and pop shops, right? And our main competition was not even Paytm. Our main competition was cash, right? So we identified what are the key problems in this whole journey. So some of the very, it's like these are nuances that could make or break a product, right? You can build this product sitting in your office, trying to solve a lot of things in your mind, right? But when you go to the ground, you actually figure out, right? Problems like usually these merchant shops are underground in the basement because that is where the whole, it is easier, bigger space for them. And in underground places, Wi-Fi, the data networks are very bad, right? So all of a sudden your QR code, your all the jazzy solutions that you thought would work doesn't work, right? All of a sudden you are down to say SMS or some other ways, mechanisms in which you would do that, right? Offline space is built by people who like, this is a very tech deficient space wherein technology investments have not happened over a period of time. And people are actually working on older versions of Internet Explorer wherein you can't even load your website. So that is the kind of technology space which you're talking about. So it was a very impactful in terms of learning of what your customer needs are and how do you understand that what are the right problems to solve and by being a part in the life of a customer. So you can always build these solutions in your offices, but until or unless you sit with your customer, live his life, you will not be able to understand what are the core problems, what are the pain points, and how do we solve those problems. So again, know your users and design for impact. Let's go further. And this journey is actually really close to my heart. I think what we did over a period of time was that we've scaled this from a few thousand dollars to in millions, right? So I don't want to put that number out, but in millions. And what the journey has taught me, I think, whatever we are thinking, you definitely would want to cross-validate, but because most of the time we are thinking from our own context and sometimes like simple things that we are building are something that people don't understand, right? So in this case, what we were trying to do is we were trying to create the whole product journey. And by the way, this is still work in progress. We are kind of trying to experiment with another model. So in this, what we did was that one was that we take a call that it is very easy, right? And when you look at a classified space, very simple classical classified space playbook that you can sell faster or you can sell more. In sell faster, you basically show more visibility, something like sponsored links in Google. If you are a dealer, you would want to post your inventory onto the platform and hence you sell. For a particular fee, you would want to participate onto the platform. Very simple, right? And you could just think about this journey, bring out the products and launch it, right? Make sure that it is consistent and everything. But when we talked to our users, right, we were actually astonished, right? They didn't understand the various variants that we were trying to sell. In their mind, if I'm paying OLX, right? As a dealer also, if I'm paying OLX, I am paying for not only the paid listing, but also it's more visibility. I'm not paying for only the feature ad or boost to top. By the way, what is feature ad? What is boost to top? No one gets it, right? So these are some of the problems. So we thought that, okay, let's educate our users. So that's a very, very fancy term, right? Like we've used all the bookmarks and all the education tutorials, right? So we said, okay, let's do an experiment that we put a C example over here. And when you click on it, we'll have an animation of what this product does, right? And to our surprise, when we launched this, we figured that people who are going in and looking at the animation, their conversion is no better than the people who are actually going on this screen and then taking a decision. So it was not about like what is it that we are selling. It was more about how does this solve my problem, which is I want to sell faster or sell more, right? So that is where we are now changing this whole into some other experiments that we are trying to do. And every step we are learning and refining this whole journey. And what we have seen is over a period of time, this has actually resulted in a huge impact in terms of scaling up the revenues. So let's go further. So these are some of the results which I was talking about in the journey, right? We failed a lot, right? In each of these journeys, I think we've failed a lot. We've learned a lot, but that every learning is an excitement in itself. Every failure is an excitement in itself. So don't be afraid to place bets. Don't be afraid to fail, but do one thing that you don't repeat that same mistake that you did, right? Learn from the mistakes. Learn from as much as you can from your user, from his pain points, and then try to figure out in your mind what are the variants of solution and how do you roll this out into the market. So Wink, as I told, from about 15 million, we were able to do about 45 million in offline. Like, we really scaled really well when it comes to offline payments. OLX, this is a growing story, right? This is still a growing story. We scaled it up from India, Indonesia, LATAM. We the same services are being used in Europe, and it is delivering. So very proud of all this, but I think all of this has a lot of failure also in it. So yeah, I think this was the last slide. Key takeaways from my side, I think maybe let's go through the takeaways. The first one is that, again, focus on problems rather than solutions while prioritizing. I think we product managers and business stakeholders have a bias towards solution, right? We think that there is already a solution. Why can't we just copy and paste this, right? But solution copying pasting is also comes with a risk that the context in which that particular solution works may not work in your context, right? So focus on the problems, focus on how do you validate that these are indeed the right problems to solve, and then go further. Next step. So again, target audience, it starts with your user, right? What is your user? How do you design for impact? And rather than blindly following a competition, what is it that you can do to learn more about your customer? And then it's okay to fail. It's perfectly fine. As long as you are learning about the users, do more experiments. And the more evolved product teams are people who have built platforms in which you can do more experiments. So I'm not talking only about A/B tests. A/B tests is just one way of doing it, but also systems and processes to do usability testing, systems and processes to go to the customers. Like, for example, we work with dealers. We would actually sit down with dealers and basically see him run the shop in a day, right? So that's how we do it. So think of what is it that you can do to make those systems so that you can do more experiments with minimal cost as we move forward. So again, this also comes to a very important point, that what we do in usually in products, right? There is always this pressure of timelines, right? There's always this delivery pressure, and that is where this whole framework goes for a toss. So that is where I would typically align my stakeholders, that this is an infinite game, right? If you really want to play this game, you should consider it as an infinite game, and rather than restricting yourself in terms of what is it that you can do now, think of where is your end state. What is it that you can do in your current resourcing to be able to go to that end state, right? So as soon as you do that, that conversation with your stakeholders becomes really relevant and really useful for everyone. Let's go further. And of course, have loads of fun, right? I think this is what I've learned. Building, validating hypothesis, questioning why. I think there's this beautiful book by Simon Sinek about start with why. That really sets this up really well, that why, how and what is the whole journey of a product lifecycle, and that is what is reflecting in this problem opportunity discovery backlog. And last, keep it simple, right? Keep it really simple. I think the simpler you keep it, the more you have fun, the more you learn, and the more you are into solving actually problems that matter. So that was it from my side. Now open to questions.
Thank you, Jasjeet. That was really, a wonderful recipe, and we thoroughly enjoyed it. And I'm sure most of our audience would definitely have. Before we kind of get into the question and answer session team, we have posted a link for the feedbacks on the chat window. We would love to hear your feedbacks on how the session went, what we can do to further strengthen down the upcoming session, and what you thought about this session. Having said that, you can ask your questions to Jasjeet. Yeah, the forum is open. Thank you. So Jasjeet, would you like me to kind of remove from this presentation, or would you like?
Yeah, that's fine.
Be fine. Sure. Thank you.
Hey, Jasjeet. Thanks for the presentation. So in my, I work in ThoughtWorks, but in my previous company, I worked in a product management team, which had an enterprise product. It wasn't a B2C product, but a B2B product. There we had a different set of problems. The first problem was our user base was really small. So we didn't, the sample size was really small. So we didn't exactly have similar problems across them. How do you focus on that? And the second question is, in these kind of enterprise products, the buyer and the user, the buyer persona and the user persona differs. The executives are buying and the user person. So there, when we frequently pitch our products, we see that the user persona wants comfort for their users, but the buyer persona typically focuses on the revenue, the features which are on the revenue. So how do we prioritize between two, and how do we go about it?
So I think every journey has its own unique nuances. So when it comes to B2B, of course, where now what the advantage, so again, the focus on the advantage. The advantage that you have is you don't have a million users to worry about. You have a few handful users. So can you build a relationship with them and understand their pain points, and basically build that journey which really, really helps them do their job that they are trying to do. And in this case, like usually the framework like jobs to be done works really, really well, because now you have a clear set of users and a clear set of like, these are my jobs, these are the pain points, these are the outcomes. So again, the basic crux is that from journey to journey, there are different frameworks that you could use to kind of bring that out. And in terms of prioritization, I think, again, that's where I would say that it depends on what is the objective that you're trying to do, right? It boils down to that. So in your mind, in stakeholders' mind, it should be absolutely clear. Is it revenue that you're going after? Is it engagement that you're going after? What is that North Star to which you want to fly off? And if that is clear with all the stakeholders, then prioritization is very simple, right? Because then everything can be quantified to that, stack ranked and executed.
Thank you. That was very clear.
Yeah. Hi, Jasjeet. Jasjeet, my question is around, you know, the current situation, right? You mentioned that, you know, we need to understand the customer, spend time with the person, and that seems very valid. Even the projects we are working on, right? If it's a new domain, we would actually like to be there, because it's difficult to relate to, like, you know, from conversation, right? What you said is very right. So in this situation, right, how are you changing your approach to ensure, you know, the same amount of success, but with the constraint of not being able to travel or be there with the person, right?
Yeah, so very good question. So I think in the last few months, I think this has been one of the toughest durations of time for everyone, right? And what we did, right? I'll tell you what we did. So what we did was that we together with the research teams, we changed the process of how we collect feedback, and we basically do the usability. So what we started doing is WhatsApp calls. So again, our target audience are dealers. So with the help of our research team, we actually started doing WhatsApp call with them, and showing them prototypes and something that we would send them, they would play with it. And we could then, there are tools and services that capture whatever the user is doing. We analyze these interviews and recordings and then basically gain knowledge out of it. So again, we are also trying to innovate on the ways we actually do this, right? Instead of being physically present, can we do this digitally over tools and services that are currently there? And that is one part of the thing. The other part is, I think what we do is typically look at the what part. The what part is something that we look via data, basis whatever experience that we have currently. Can we understand what is happening over there? And then build out problem hypotheses on why. And once you have the clear problem hypothesis, then it becomes very clear to you and to other person that is, what is it that you want to do? And hence it reduces the time that you need to be with a particular person to gather feedback. So that is where we are doing, that is what we are doing more in order to circumvent this whole this situation.
Thank you, Rishit.
Yeah, any further questions, guys? The forum is still open. You can post your queries to the master chef, Jasjeet, with us.
By the way, I'm really bad at cooking. So in my bachelor days, I was unfortunately made responsible for cooking, and I made dal a couple of times, which was more like a cake. So it was an innovation. It was called cake dal at that point in time. But my batchmates then they understood the problem over there, and they said that, yeah, you do something else.
Okay, so in that case, I believe from that's when the journey of a successful product manager started. So yeah, the dal cake is the secret behind Jasjeet's tremendous success today. So we all will agree to that point. Okay, so we'd wait for
one more. Quick question, Jasjeet.
Yes.
Hey, Sapna.
Yeah, hi. So amongst the various type of ways of testing a product is amongst the various ways which are available while testing a product during development, you know, how do you classify which one is best suited for what? Is there like a broad principle? I know it will vary on a case-to-case basis, but is there a broad framework or a principle you could share?
So the answer to this question is it depends, right? So again, fortunately, unfortunately, product management is not that structured, and there is a good reason for that, of course, because there is what the secret sauce is that I think I told you about the truth curve, right? So this is exactly what answers the question, that what is it that what are the knowns, what are the unknowns, what are the risks, and what is that fidelity of experiment that you need to do to be able to take a call that now, is it good enough for me to roll it out in the market, or should I do some more experiments, or should I talk to my users more, or is this good enough? So that is where the fidelity of your testing actually you get a better hold of that.
Okay. I'll just clarify a little more so that you can help me answer the question which is in my head. So there are various ways of testing. There would be a usability test. There would be an A/B test. You know, there could be qualitatives that you could do. I was asking for the framework around that.
Yeah. So maybe Bisma, if you could go to that truth curve slide. Yes. So Sapna, in this is the framework that I at least in my mind, I use. So basically that is what I was saying, that the fidelity or the effort that is needed to test a particular hypothesis is, and a function of the risks or the unknowns over there, defines for me that is, should I go for a paper test? Should I go for a prototype? Should I go for a live product? Should I go for an A/B test? Should I go for a segment rollout? Or what, right? So this is where the whole magic of deciding how do we test this out in the market is there. But of course, this is case by case basis, wherein sometimes you have a better comfort feeling and hence you say that, okay, this is good enough to go live with. And sometimes you feel that no, there are certain hypotheses which I still want to know before I roll it out into the market.
Got it. Okay. Sorry for not being able to correlate to this earlier. Got it.
No worries. So I think this is what goes in my mind, at least when I am working.
Yeah.
Any other question, anything that I can help you with? So in any case, I think I am on LinkedIn. I'm pretty active over there. So if you have any questions, anything that I can help you with, feel free to reach out and I'll try my best to help you out.
Jasjeet, has there been any, any particular use case which stands out in your head, which you were finding very difficult to solve and, maybe you were not able to solve? Anything that any anecdotal story you can share?
I think it happens a lot, right? It happens a lot wherein you think you're going in a particular direction, but it is not that direction, right? So I think this happened when this was for Indonesia. We were trying to roll out. We were looking at different markets and we figured that wallet is something that is having a lot of negative impact in the overall conversion. So we decided to remove the wallet. But the problem with the market was that the dealers were self-serving and hence they would typically select multiple products and basically the money would be in the wallet. It would deduct automatically one after the other, right? And over there, we said that, okay, let's this was again a usability testing. We said, okay, we'll remove the wallet, but we will give them a checkout process, something similar to Flipkarts of the world, wherein they can, you have one option in which you have a drop down and people would select that and do the checkout. We were very confident that this is something that the likes of Flipkarts, the likes of Amazon have been doing. This would definitely work. But when we showed it to our dealers or to the users also, so again, both consumers and the dealers, we were really sad, right? We were really like, people would not get it. People said that, I want to compare two or three products, right? I want to compare what is the product that we would want to typically, why should I purchase this versus that? I want to select multiple packages together and then do the checkout. So there were a lot of nuances that we were actually totally missing in our prototypes. So in the next iteration, we actually did this wherein whatever you see now in the packages section is something that we came out and it worked really, really well. But of course, initially as a prototype level, it was a big failure for us because we invested quite a lot in it. We designed it and we went to the users with our prototypes, thinking that whatever minor feedback would be there, we'll do that and we launch. But it was not the case.
That's interesting. Thank you.
Yeah, definitely. I will echo with it's like the same thing. Many setbacks across a product launch will definitely get to the finished product at the end. Am I correct, Jasjeet?
Yes, for sure.
Cool. Thank you so much. So we can take a couple of more questions, Jasjeet, because we have time.
Sure.
Yeah. So in the interest of audience, we can take a few more questions.
Sure.
Yeah.
Hi, Jasjeet. Vaibhav here.
Hey, Vaibhav.
One question. So in the case studies which you have discussed, so you have shown that there was a kind of a comparison between two options. So generally, it also happens otherwise in our day-to-day basis in our product managers' life that there are various ways and we need to not only decide ourselves that which way we should go, but also need to align the stakeholders.
Yes.
So, for example, in your cases, Wink case especially, one of the options was pretty fancy looking vis-a-vis the other option. So, in these kind of scenarios, what all different variables are there which you take care of in mind to use while convincing the stakeholders that yes, instead of building a new feature, new fancier feature, we should go ahead and do a more user research, because building also takes time, but user research also takes time and efforts, and sometimes it can become really very tricky to convince the stakeholders that yes, user research is something which we need to do in order to get good returns and good benefits to the customers as well.
Yes.
So what all variables do you consider in those kind of scenarios?
So I would say two things. I think golden rule for me, at least in my conversation with my stakeholders, is data, right? So I think, can you tell your story with what is happening right now and basically create that fear, right? So how do you sell your story? You can sell your story either by creating fear that this is something that if you don't do, we are messed up, right? Whatever investments that you do other than this will not yield to this particular impact that you're trying to get. So that is something that use your data really well, right? Use the drop-offs well. Use the whole story or the narrative around why this is indeed a big problem. And that is where your problem opportunity assessment will help you. And the other thing is, I think you should be using the same language that your stakeholders are used to, right? If there is an alignment on a North Star or something that that you would want to achieve as a group together, right? Can you convince them in a story that basically aligns to that narrative, right? So these are the two things that really, really have helped me over a period of time. So I was also fortunately, when it comes to OLX, right? I work in monetization and the dealers, right? So fortunately, I have to deal with very strong sales teams, very strong business teams, right? So one thing that I have built over a period of time is a lot of relationships into doing the right thing, right? I want to help them out in their story that they want to be more successful. Yes, of course, I'll do whatever it takes to make you more successful. But the way of how do we reach that state is something that we need to align on when it comes to data, when it comes to understanding the user customer pain points. So that is where it is a win. Then your conversation is not about I'll say this, you say this, who wins, whoever has a large stake or a huge or a big mouth wins. That's not how things work. You need to make sure that your story is strong enough for people to believe in you so that you can carry the whole team together in one, understanding the problem space and then discovering solutions together. And that is where the point of co-creation comes very important, that can you take your stakeholders along this journey rather than, because we also have a bias, right? We also want to make sure that until unless this is completely done, I don't want to share it with everyone, right? That is where the other problem comes, that it is too late because you have pressure from tech team, you have pressure from business team, right? You are building things in isolation. That is where the whole thing breaks, right? So start being open to feedback and also giving feedback and aligning on what are the things that matter. And with business, what I've also learned over a period of time is that if you can get business to focus only on the problems and rather than solutions, it becomes a very, 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 very interesting conversation. And that is where you take a step back, you think of all the variants of solutions that solve a problem, and then you look at what do you have and what is it that needs to be done to come up with solutions that actually bring impact.
Okay. Yeah, understood the points. Thanks for the answer, Jaseed.
Hi, Jesse, Anil here. I have one question from your experience. Have you felt somewhere at the beginning, somewhere you had a very strong sense that this is the product to hit the market, but on your journey you found out that I was totally wrong.
So in a product life of a product manager, right, this happens quite a bit, right? And I'll be honest here, we've had failures, right? And this happened let me think of an example. This happened. This was a sure shot win for us, and it didn't turn out that way. So I was in MobiQuick, right? And that is where we said that for a merchant product, we would create this fancy website wherein all his account management, all the transactions, all the booking of transactions, everything under the sun would be built, right? And we started building this. We were, I think, about 2 months into the development, and then we said, okay, let's do a small launch and figure out what feedback do we get, and so that let's not take a too big of a risk that you worked on this 6 months and then nothing works, right? So we went out in the market, and to our surprise, that is the example that I gave was that the Internet Explorer was also the initial version, that the website also didn't launch, right? That is the kind of failure that we have to deal with, that how do you build for such a thing, right? How do you make sure that the POS machines that the people that they are using, are they compatible to the products that you are building, right? So it happens quite a bit of time wherein we think that we have done, even after due diligence, right? This was after talking, we have had conversations with people who use these POS, people who build these POS, but nowhere we found that there was this technical feasibility problem which would actually derail the whole project.
Okay, thank you, Lizzie.
Okay, so if the audience don't have any further questions, I guess we can stop the question answer session until now.
So I would really like to thank ThoughtWorks and the team. I think this was an amazingly well-organized event. So thanks for inviting me.
Thank you, Jasjeet, for those lines. Yes, I will definitely echo with the rest of the audience that what a wonderful experience the past 1.5 hours was. We explored a lot of insight into the product management. We have some cool and amazing stories right from the ground level. Yes, I believe many audience dig for that. So having said that, to the audience, please do give us your feedback. We have shared the feedback link in the chat because we value feedback a lot. And this definitely helps us in improving the future sessions of BizNight and also incorporate what went wrong, what could have been done better. We really look forward to it. And if you have any further questions, we will be shooting out an email. You can just post your questions if you feel like your questions went answered, or you feel like you need more answers to your thoughts. Please do let us know, and we'll pass them on to Jasjeet. And like Jasjeet said, he is available on LinkedIn for you to connect. So feel happy to send him a friend request. So having said that, I would like to thank Jasjeet for kind of taking out his time and sharing his input with all of us. That was very, very enlightening, Jasjeet. And also, I would like to thank the BizNight Core Committee. They worked really well to make this happen. And we're in the sixth edition, and there will be a lot of more to follow. On those lines, the next BizNight topic is productizing omni-channel distribution and reverse logistics. So please come over, join us as we share some more topics and have a wonderful session ahead. Having said that, I would like to kind of end the session here. Thank you all for joining tonight. Have a great weekend ahead. I think we're almost there. We'll definitely agree to it. And yes, keep safe in this pandemic time. Just stay home, stay safe. And thank you all for joining once again. Thank you, everybody. Thanks for joining.
Thank you.
See you again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.